Panic plays no part in the training of a nurse.
She's a pioneer for women, you know, a very strong personality, had beliefs, had a belief system, and put it into action, words in, and beliefs into action.
Polio struck the U.S. in 1919. Many children and adults were hospitalized and bound by harsh metal braces and confined in hospitals all over America. 16 to 35 years is what the doctors told them. That is how long they would be confined to the metal equipment strapped to their bodies. It is only when Sister Elizabeth Kenny came to the United States in 1940 that the lives would be changed for those thousands of polio victims. In 1940, at the peak of the polio epidemic, Sister Elizabeth Kenny, an Australian nurse, changed the medical field of physical therapy by introducing muscle re-education to polio victims. Her idea and teachings left a lasting impression on physical therapy as we know it today. Elizabeth Kenny was born in Warialda, South New Wales, Australia in 1886. She was a very active child. When she was in her teens, she broke her wrist during a fall from her horse. Her doctor, Aeneas MacDonald, showed her textbook diagrams of the bones and muscles and how they worked as he mended her broken arm. She was instantly fascinated and eventually memorized all the bones and muscles in the body and how they worked. Kenny wanted to help the injured and signed up to be an Australian bush nurse, even though she had never received any formal training. She did everything from broken bones to delivering babies. When she saw her first case of infantile paralysis in 1911, she immediately used her knowledge of muscle use, applied hot pieces of wool, and started to move the crippled limbs. The young girl healed, and Kenny started to get more cases and many letters requesting advice. When World War I broke out, Kenny joined the Australian Medical Corps. It was then she earned the title Sister, and she kept it throughout her life. Kenny returned to her hometown in Australia after the war and continued to care for patients. In 1933, Kenny invented the Sylvia stretcher to more easily transport patients and better their treatment. She used the earnings she made from selling her invention to open her own clinic for the treatment of polio patients in Toowoomba, Australia. Sister Kenny's method brought her into controversy with the medical authorities in Australia, but she pushed forward with her treatment method and found success. Kenny's ideas quickly spread around the globe and she became more popular. Her ideas made her greatly sought after in the United States. In 1940, after 31 successful years treating polio in Australia, Sister Kenny and her adopted daughter Mary traveled to the United States. They arrived in San Francisco, where they were transferred to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. To Kenny's amazement, medical officials in America were generally not receptive to her advice, and she became discouraged. Before leaving for home, Kenny decided to take one last trip. Sister Kenny and Mary traveled to Minneapolis General Hospital, where Kenny decided to fight back against what the doctors were saying, with the help of her old friend, Dr. MacDonald. Kenny pressed on.
He who angers you, conquers you.
Sister Kenny visited President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who was confined to a wheelchair with polio. She was a very popular woman at the time. In fact, she was even more popular than Roosevelt's wife, Eleanor. She was so famous that three movies were made after her. Kenny was soon assigned a ward in the Minneapolis General Hospital, and when that got too small for all the influx of patients, Kenny convinced local families that a building was needed to effectively continue her work. The small group remodeled an old school at 1800 Chicago Avenue as a rehabilitation center, and on December 17, 1942, the Sister Kenny Institution was dedicated. Thank you. Institute was used not only for treating polio patients, but also for Kenny to teach her methods to doctors and other medical officials around the country. When the iron lung was invented, it was put to use at the Kenny Institute, used for patients with paralyzed muscles in their chests that needed help breathing and couldn't do it on their own. As Kenny's method spread, multiple Kenny clinics and other treatment centers were established, practicing the Kenny method and helping polio victims all around the United States. Not only do therapists learn the Kenny method, but Lynn Fulstead tells us about the necessity of a well-rounded education that is needed to work at a prestigious Kenny Institute.
Maths and sciences and the social aspects of psychologies. Beginning, you learn something as simple as, this sounds odd, but how to put a pillowcase on back in the day. And then draping procedures, working with people, confidentiality, very basic one-on-one human people skills. And then they get into the modalities, the exercise, anatomy, physiology, the human body, kinesiology, how it moves, how it functions. I was very fortunate to be able to actually have anatomy physiology class where we could work with in a cadaver lab. So you're right there working with the human body, and it's just really, it was very, very interesting.
Today, there are 38 Sister Kenny clinics across the United States, and the Kenny Institute in Minneapolis, Minnesota still stands, serving as a rehabilitation center and physical therapy learning ground for paralyzed patients. Kenny cured thousands of polio patients worldwide. The positive impact of Sister Kenny continues in physical therapy.
They are so amazing. They just have this wonderful energy that they put everything into their patients. Their goal is to give them the highest quality of life they can, from something as, I don't want to say simple, it's not simple, but something like a total knee that has a specific end date usually, to the quadriplegic who has to totally learn how to live again after such a traumatic type of disability. You see a broad range of patients there, and it doesn't matter what the diagnosis, the therapist just really put their all into it, and you feed on that energy. It's really, really exciting.
Kenny returned to Australia with health issues in early 1950s. She died 2 years later on November 30th, 1952. She will be forever remembered for her astounding treatment methods that greatly changed the world of physical therapy as we know today. Sister Kenny was truly a miracle for polio.
When I got home, I looked up the word polio, an acute viral disease resulting in motor paralysis followed by muscular atrophy and often by permanent deformities. The last two words frightened me at first, and then I thought this new method would prevent that from happening to me. I looked at my arm for the first time since the cast had been removed. I saw myself actually throwing a ball. I said a prayer, thanking God, and a special thank you to Sister Kenny.